It's my real honor and privilege to introduce my colleague and my friend, Asghar Farhadi, who is I mean, I would, from far as I'm concerned, he is one of the greatest filmmakers. I would say the greatest contemporary filmmakers, but I think he's one of the greatest filmmakers. And I say that as a filmmaker, I could say that about in an easy way about all kinds of different sorts of filmmakers. But I particularly feel so strongly about Asghar and his films because I feel they are as close to my kind of spirit of filmmaking as any filmmaker I know, because he deals so compassionately and in such depth with the human experience. He really has this extraordinary ability, which I think we may talk about, to put on the screen real people in a real way, which is something that some of us aspire to, but he really does achieve it. So it's a great honor to be here and to be able to talk to him. We know each other because, in the first place, I had the privilege of being the president of the jury at Berlin some years ago, and Asghar was on the jury, and we had a really good time.
Yeah, it was very good, very fun time.
And we've had other experiences since, including all of us together. I wanted to start off.
Let's before that, I say, سلام میکنم و میخوام بگم که امروز خیلی روز زیبایی برای من که بعد از سالها مایک رو از نزدیک دوباره دیدمش. توی مدت با هم در ارتباط بودیم ولی وقتی دیدمش یه خیلی انرژی خوبی باز گرفتم.
I want to salute you all and also to say what a great joy it is to gather with you again. We've been in touch, but just seeing you again make me feel a lot of energy.
So
همه این چیزهایی که مایک گفت فکر کنم بیشتر برای فیلم‌های خودش که کار کرده و من چقدر از فیلم‌هاش لذت بردم و چقدر یاد گرفتم در مورد فیلم‌های خودش صادقه واقعا چون فیلم‌هایی هستن برخلاف خیلی از فیلم‌هایی که این روزها می‌بینیم راجع به رابطه واقعی آدم‌ها و زندگی واقعی آدم‌ها یعنی من در واقع اون زودتر شروع کردم و من یاد گرفتم ازش
and as the description that you just gave, I think that they are really valid about your own films, and I must say that I've learned a lot from your films, dealing with real people and real relationships and real human issues is something that you started long before me, and I learned a lot from your cinema.
Well, I'm very flattered, thank you.
Thank you.
But we'll stop this love fest, which, I mean, otherwise you'll all start drifting away because you'll be both bored and embarrassed by this. We've a lot to talk about, and many of Asghar's films will be familiar to you, but you started in Iran by you went to dramatics, and then you did a film.
Thing. Yes.
But where did your filmmaking start very early on? What was the first thing that drew you to filmmaking?
من اول که اولین فیلم کوتاهم رو 13 سالم بود که ساختم.
I shot my first short film when I was 13.
و خیلی برام عجیبه الان به بچه خودم که 13 سالشه نگاه میکنم همیشه فکر میکنم که من تو سن این چجوری بقیه آدم ها جدی گرفتن منو و کمک کردن که من فیلم کوتاه بسازم
And now that I'm a father of a 13-year-old I look at her and I think how strange it is that people took me seriously at the time at that age and let me make a film
هر سال یه فیلم کوتاه ساختم که فیلم های خیلی ساده و با امکانات خیلی کم با دوربین سوپر 8 بود
So every year I would come up with this new short film. It was always a very simple story with a very low budget with a Super 8 camera.
و بعد رفتم دانشگاه که سینما بخونم ولی به طور اتفاقی من رو تئاتر قبول کردم. خیلی ناراحت بودم ولی وقتی وارد دانشگاه شدم و با دنیای تئاتر آشنا شدم فکر کردم که هنوزم احساس کنم که این بزرگترین شانس زندگی من بود.
Then I wanted to go to the film school but I wasn't taken there. I was taken in drama school. And that was a great frustration to begin with. But once that I went there and I discovered the world of theater and drama, I realized that it was the greatest chance that I had had for my life to discover a new world.
ولی اینکه از کی علاقه‌مند شدم به سینما، من یادم اولین باری که رفتم تو سالن سینما با پسرمون بودیم توی شهر دیگه، تو شهر ما یه شهر کوچیکی بود و بعد با اتوبوس می‌رفتیم به شهر دیگه که فیلم ببینیم. و یه فیلمی رو رسیدیم، یه فیلم در واقع غیر ایرانی بود که ما از وسط رسیدیم و تا آخر دیدیم و وقتی برمیگشتیم ما دو تا بچه، من تمام روزهای بعد فکر می‌کنم که نیمه اول فیلم چی بوده و فکر کنم علاقه و لذت بردن از ساختن قصه از اونجا برای من شروع شد، از اون روز شروع شد.
As for my love of cinema, I think it all started when I went for the first time with my cousin to see a film. In our small town, there was no theater, so we had to take a bus and to go to another city to find a film theater. And we arrived, it was a foreign movie, and we arrived in the middle of the film. And we watched the second half of it. And then on our way back, and also for the days after, I kept imagining what the first half of the film had to be. And I think my love of storytelling started at that moment.
ولی به حقیقتش اینه که رشته آشنا شدن با ادبیات نمایشی دنیا، کارهای ایبسن، چخوف، برشت، اینها بود که خیلی قضیه رو جدی کرد برای من و اون موقع فکر کردم من همه عمرم فقط تئاتر کار خواهم کرد. سینما دیگه برام یه چیز دوم شد.
But then at the time discovering the world of theater plays, the world heritage of what I started to know, Ibsen, Brecht or Chekhov made me realize that cinema was a second best for me, that my favorite was theater, and that's what I wanted to dedicate the rest of my life to.
هنوزم اینجوریه، یعنی نمایشنامه‌نویسای دنیا برام در اولویت بزرگتری هست.
Even now I keep thinking that the great playwrights of the world are my favorite.
Well, now this is very interesting to me because as you know, my own background is also in theater. Although I knew that I wanted to make films. But I certainly think that my experience in constructing plays helped considerably in my ability to construct films. Now, one of the great things about your films, all of them, without exception, is the way you handle really complex and detailed and multi-leveled dramatic construction and the thoroughness with which you make things happen, which, I mean, do you think that had you not had that theatre background, you wouldn't be able to do that in your movies?
فکر کنم که نه. من اگرچه فیلم هم به لحاظ ظاهری هیچ نسبتی از در ظاهرشون با تئاتر ندارن، خیلی بازی‌ها به زندگی نزدیکه، روایت به زندگی نزدیکه، ولی تو عمقشون خیلی برآمدن از اون چیزی که من از تئاتر گرفتم.
Definitely, I think on the surface of my films you cannot tell that they are inspired by theater because they are very lively, realistic sets of life. But then if you have a deeper look, I think the structure of my films really come from my acquaintance with theater.
Absolutely. یه چیزی که توی تئاتر یاد گرفتم و هنوز بهش باور دارم اینه که شما هر شب که یه نمایش رو می‌بینی با اون فردا شب که می‌بینی یه چیز دیگه است، از زاویه‌های مختلف می‌تونی ببینی. من اینکه بستگی داره که صندلیت کجا باشه توی این سالن یه جور دیگه می‌بینیم، انگار که یه نمایشنامه پنجره‌های مختلفی دورشه و هر شب از یه پنجره می‌تونی ببینی. این تو سینما کمتر اتفاق می‌افته. من سعی کردم در فیلم‌ها وقتی فیلمو می‌بینه تماشاگر بتونه هر بار از یه زاویه‌ای ببینه.
Something that I learned from theater and I still strongly believe in is that when you have this theater play that is being shown every night is a new experience depending on where you're sitting, depending on where you come from that evening. you'll have a different experience, you'll have a different gaze, a different approach, a different angle to approach what's been shown on stage. And this, of course, cinema allows this less, but I tend to try and have this multiplicity of point of views in my films.
And you succeed.
Moving
forward a bit, just say a little bit about your television writing and your television work.
وقتی که تئاتر کار می‌کردم توی دانشگاه بودم شروع کردم نمایشنامه نوشتن و چند تا کار رو هم کارگردانی کردم و بعد کسایی که اومدن کارمو دیدم یکیشون خواست که برم رادیو و نمایشنامه رادیویی بنویسم که اون چون به لحاظ مالی هم درآمد داشت برام خیلی کمک کرد که من زندگیم یه ثباتی پیدا کنه.
So I started playing writing plays and also directing a few of them when I was still a student. And so when my plays were seen, people who came and saw me once, a guy came to me and offered me a position to go and write radio plays. And that allowed me to make a living. So that's how I started actually living out of it.
نمایشنامه‌هایی که برای رادیو نوشتم اپیزودیک بود. مثلا در یه هفته پنج قسمتش پخش شد و من یه داستان رو در پنج قسمت بعد این تعلیق رو توش ایجاد می‌کردم و این قصه‌گویی من رو خیلی تقویت کرد.
And especially the structure of this play that I had to write for radio really helped me in a way because it was in different episodes. So there were like 5 episodes in 1 week. So I started writing one episode and then I had to have this suspense that made people listen to the next episode. And I think that's really how I developed my way of writing.
و بعد چون نیاز مالی زیادی داشتم در اون مقطعی دانشجو بودم و درآمدی نداشتم خیلی زیاد می نوشتم یعنی هر روز ساعت 6 صبح بیدار می شدم و می نوشتم و این باعث شد که دست من راحت بشه تو نوشتن.
And because I was a student and I was really needing money at the time, I would work a lot and produce a lot. So I would wake up every morning at 6 and start writing, and that's what made me fluent as a writer.
I mean, it's interesting. But I mean, you talk about suspense. I mean, it's just occurred to me, and it wouldn't have occurred to me before. Of course, actually, you are the master of suspense. Mm-hmm. Now, they usually say that about Alfred Hitchcock. But Alfred Hitchcock really, I don't think he made a single film that held a lighted candle to one of Asghar's films in terms of depicting the real world. What we sit on the edge of our seats throughout all of your films, you know, wondering what the hell's going to happen next. Mm. and it is interesting that's where you
این از رادیو و تلویزیون اومد چون اونجا تماشاگرت و شنونده رادیو خیلی زود خاموش میکنه تو باید هر جوری هست تلاش کنی که با شکل قصه نگرش داری.
Exactly, that comes from radio and then TV, because for a radio listener it's very easy to turn off the radio and go and do something else. Yeah. So you really have to catch their attention.
دوره‌ای که توی رادیو می‌نوشتم و بعد تو تلویزیون سریال می‌نوشتم بیشتر وجه کمرشال اون فیلم‌ها پررنگ بود، ولی در کنار اون وجه من اینکه چگونه تماشاگر گسترده‌تری رو جذب کنم رو اونجا تجربه کردم.
When first on this radio plays and then working for TV series, it was more commercial projects, but still I used them to try and develop my way of storytelling.
و شاید اگر اون پروسه رو طی نمی‌کردم تبدیل می‌شدم به فیلمسازی که براش مهم نبود چه تعداد تماشاگر فیلماش رو می‌بینن.
And what was interesting for me to try and gather as a large audience as possible around my storytelling. And maybe if I hadn't been through this process, then I would have become who somebody would have worked or made films for a very targeted audience.
من به نظرم قصه گفتن چیزیه که همه آدم های دنیا دوست دارن. چون ما از بچگی با قصه به خواب میریم. با قصه در واقع خیلی مانوس هستیم. و حالا من سعی می‌کنم که ببینم چگونه میشه قصه‌ای که دارم میگم کهنه شکل روایتش کهنه نباشه.
I think storytelling is really the base of our lives, all of us. No matter where we were born, we go to sleep listening to stories. Our lives are built on these narratives. But for me, very early, what was interesting was to find a new way of telling stories.
Let's just move on a bit. But before we do that, we're obliged to do something which I personally don't like in these discussions. We have to keep stopping and showing clips. So we're going to start with a clip. We'll leap forward with the clip, and then we'll go backwards to talking about. The clip is from the Farhadi classic, A Separation, from right near the beginning of the film. It'll be useful to see it and then talk about some aspects of it in relation to what you do more broadly. So can we see the first clip, please? I mean, you can take that at its face value. But actually, what we know we have to be looking at is a most profoundly thorough piece of writing and rehearsal. Mm-hmm. And, you know, you've presumably, am I right in thinking that you've rehearsed it and rehearsed it and rehearsed it? And that's just, by the way, if you know the film, you will know that that's just the end of a much longer scene, which starts the film. I mean, it kicks off with that. I'm right in thinking, presumably, that you really, really simply rehearse and rehearse and rehearse and get it precise and then shoot it. Is that correct?
همون شیوهی که خود مایکلی انجام میده. یعنی حالا در واقع مایک در حین تمرین و فیلمنامه هم شروع میکنه ساختن که برای من خیلی حیرت انگیزه این کار. ولی این بخش فیلمنامه و تمرین به بازیگر به هر حال به نظرم مهمترین کاری که من دارم انجام میدم سر فیلم.
Yes, that's quite close to what you do, which is rehearse and rehearse and actually write out of this rehearsal. This is something that I find fascinating, but definitely for me too, writing and rehearsing is the main part of what I do on a film.
من البته اول می نویسم و چیز کلی پیدا میشه و بعد تمرین ها رو شروع می کنم. همزمان با تمرین کردن فقط تغییرات جزئی میدم.
But I do it in two phases. I first write until I have a structure, something to start with, and then rehearse a lot and I just have adjustments while we rehearse.
چیزی که تازگی ها متوجه شدم اینه که تمرین ها بیشتر اینکه به بازیگرها کمک کنه داره به من کمک میکنه.
What I've understood recently is that rehearsals help me more than they help my actors.
What do you mean exactly?
من وقتی که تمرین ها رو میبینم و بازیگر رو میبینم انگار دارم پروسه نوشتن و کاراکتر پردازیم رو تطبیق میدم با یه دنیای واقعی و هی تو ذهنم درستشون میکنم.
That's really by observing my actors and my characters that I go on developing the characters and making them closer to real life and to reality of the people who they are actually.
تمام اون آزمون و خطاهایی رو که سر صحنه نمیشه با بازیگر انجام داد انگار من سر تمرین ها انجام میدم و میگم این خوب نشد دوباره. یعنی بیشتر تمرین ها واقعا مال منه، به درد من میخوره.
This phase of experimentation that I cannot afford on the set, I do it beforehand during the rehearsal. So it's really for me a way of proving things and trying things with the actors.
Well, I mean, if anyone is here because they want to learn anything, I would say that is a fundamental truth about how, no matter what kind of film, how to make films and how to work with actors. There's no question about that. What's interesting, I mean, obviously we've just looked at a piece of action which on the face of it is very simple. A woman and a man and a third person we don't see and all of that. And for most of that scene, the guy stays sitting down. He only gets up at the end, and so does she. But there are so many scenes in your films where there are a lot of things going on, a lot of people, a lot of moving around. So cinematically, it's very dynamic, it's very imaginative, but always, always, the camera's in the right place. There's nothing ever extraneous or fancy or affected or superficial. It's always organic. And obviously you take from the environment as much as you take from the characters. Is that true?
Yeah. نکته‌ای که وجود داره در واقع اینه که داره تلاش میشه همه این داینامیکی که توی شخصیت پردازی، توی میزانسن، توی حرکت ها وجود داره، سخت‌ترین بخشش اینه که به نظر نیاد اینا وجود داره و شبیه زندگیه، اینا خود زندگیه.
Exactly. The main stake for me is that all this dynamic between the characters in terms of directing, of mise en scène, of the choreography of the people coming and going, being completely seamless and organic and natural.
به نظر نیاد که الان این صحنه که دیدیم خیلی برام موقعی که کار میکردم برام مهم بود که به نظر نیاد این فیلم نامه‌ای نوشته شده به نظر میاد اینا در واقع بداهه دارن یه چیزایی میگن.
For this scene, for instance, I really remember when we were shooting that I really wanted it to look completely spontaneous, as if it was improvised.
شاید چیزی که بخوام الان بگم و به درد بخوره از لحاظ آموزشی اینه که یه الگویی وجود داره به نام زندگی. یعنی همش آدم ناخودآگاه داره همه چی رو تو این نوع فیلم نزدیک میکنه به اون الگو.
Maybe if I'm supposed to say one thing that would be useful for people who want to learn about the process of filmmaking is that our reference, our ultimate reference is always life. And the idea is to try and get as close possible as life.
ولی زندگی برعکس چیزی که حالا من توضیح میدم پر از تکرار پر از چیزای اضافی و خسته کننده است که با اون تعلیقی که داشتیم صحبت کردیم در تناقضه.
But life is full of boredom, of unimportant and uninteresting things. And so so there is apparently a contradiction with suspense as we were defining it.
ما باید من حالا در کارام سعی کنم که با این زندگی که روبرو هم با این مدل از زندگی یه کاری بکنم که اون تکرارها و کسالتاش بیاد بیرون و خارج بشه.
So my idea is to take life as a pattern and to get rid of all this repetition, all this uninteresting aspect of it.
یه مثالی دارم که اینو جای دیگه گفتم، این مثال رو میگم شاید کمک کنه به اینکه منظورم چیه.
I'll have an example that I often quote, maybe it makes what I'm saying clearer.
فکر کنید که من با یه دوستی به من زنگ میزنه بعد از مدت‌ها و میگه که بیا قراری بذاریم و یه قهوه‌ای با هم یه جو بخوریم.
So imagine a friend of mine calls me and says we haven't seen each other for a while, let's go and have some coffee together.
ما با هم میریم یه جایی و بعد از مدت‌ها همدیگر رو میبینیم، حرفای اون میگه چطوری، من میگم دلم تنگ شده برات، حرفای خیلی معمولی میزنیم.
So we see each other in a cafe and we start having the very usual chit-chat together.
بعد اون به من میگه که مثلا خورشید تو چشمته، بیا جاتو عوض کن که اذیت نشی.
And then he says you're sitting in front of the sun, maybe you should change your seat.
اون میگه که خیلی خسته شدم، دلم خواهد یه سفری برم، کاش که میشد زودتر یه سفری رفت.
And then he says well I wish I could go for a trip somewhere.
بعد پول قهوه هم اون حساب میکنه و میره.
And then he pays for the coffee and leaves.
این زندگیه و هیچ چیز جالبی الان توش نبود، خیلی خسته کننده بود.
Every day's life, nothing interesting. I mean, it's a boring story.
ولی فکر کنین که این دوست بره بیرون و شب بمیره.
But if this friend leaves and at night all of a sudden he dies.
تمام این صحنه‌ای که من تعریف کردم یه شکل دیگه میشه معناش.
All of these moments that I was describing have a different meaning.
من میگم که آخ این چقدر مهربون بود، حواسش به من بود که نور آفتاب منو اذیت نکنه. من هیچ موقع متوجه نبودم این چقدر مهربونه.
I think what a sweet man he was. He was even worried for me not to sit in front of the sun, not to be bothered by the sun.
اون به من گفت که دلش تنگه و میخواد سفر بره. نکنه منظورش مردن و سفر به یه جهان دیگه بود.
He said that he was looking forward to a trip. Maybe he knew that he was going to die and that was the trip he was.
تمام اون لحظات اون زندگی نشانه‌هایی میشن.
So all of this very usual uninteresting random conversation become like signs.
در واقع توی این داستان‌هایی که حالا من می‌نویسم تلاشم اینه که به این زندگی یه بحرانی اضافه کنم که همه چیز جزئیات تبدیل بشه به نشانه.
So my aim when I'm writing a story, when I'm telling a story is to have a level of crisis of conflict in all the scenes that I depict in such way that any detail can become a sign.
That's fascinating, and it's a shame you haven't made that film, by the way. the earliest film of yours that I've seen, I haven't seen Dancing in the Dust or The Beautiful City, but I have seen, I really, really like, and I don't know whether any of you have seen it, Fireworks Wednesday, which is a great film. And what's fascinating about it is that all this stuff's going on about these people who are, for all intents and purposes, the central characters. But actually, the central character is this young woman who
comes, yeah.
who really is just there because she's got a cleaning job from an agency. And we're with her all the way through as being the central character. But it's not the things that all happen are actually happening to somebody else and things, which is the tension between that, which carries it through, apart from the internal things that happen between the various fantastically realized characters. I mean, do you want to talk about that a bit?
جالب بین فیلم‌های خودم منم اون فیلم رو دوست دارم برام یه فیلمیه که هنوز تصمیم نگرفته بودم چه نوع فیلمی رو بسازم چه نوع مسیری رو تو سینما برم و از اونجا تقریبا تو با اون فیلم فهمیدم که کدوم مسیر رو باید برم.
Yeah, I cherish this film myself because it's a moment in my life or career at which I hadn't decided yet what direction I wanted to take, and I think this one was crucial.
چیزی که تو اون فیلم برام جالب بود این که داستان در یک روز میگذره و داستان یه زندگیه که انگار رو به پایانه و یه زندگی که داره تازه با یه زوج جوان داره شروع میشه. این کنتراست این دو تا زندگی توی تایم محدود.
What was interesting for me in the script and the story of the film was that it took place in one day, so you had this unity, and in this one day there is one life that's ending and another one that's opening for this new couple.
در واقع ما به بهانه یه کارگر نظافتچی وارد یه روز زندگی زوج یه خانواده میشیم.
So with this woman who has this cleaning job, we just enter in the middle of the life of a couple.
و مدام احساس کنیم که الان موقعیت رو بهش اشراف داریم و میدونیم چه خبره و چند دقیقه بعد احساس کنیم نه اون چیزی که تصور می‌کردیم نیست، یه چیز دیگه است.
So we all the way through we feel that we are having in a position of mastery of situation, that we have everything under control and we know what's going on, and immediately after we realize that we don't.
و از اون فیلم بود که دروغ در واقع شد یکی از چیزایی که من خیلی در ذهنم درگیر شد و ناخواسته، این پلن من نبود که این کارو بکنم، ولی شد یکی از تم‌های همیشگی کارهای من.
And it's from this film on that the theme of lies was a theme that very unconsciously became one of the crucial themes of my filmmaking.
Absolutely. And I speak as the maker of Secrets and Lies,
yeah.
By the way. and your next film, about which is called About Elly in English, is, I mean, again, there's this enigmatic thing. What is this woman up to? What's happened? And of course, I mean, I wouldn't want to talk about the whole film, because if anyone sees it who hasn't, I wouldn't want to give a spoiler, because it's definitely a film where you could easily spoil the end by explaining it. But there's a tension between what's going on one level and what's happening to everybody else, and that's the same thing, isn't it, really?
توی درباره‌ای درباره اتفاقی که افتاد، شاید بیشتر باز ناخودآگاه، من روی این کلمه خیلی تاکید دارم، این بود که در واقع شاید اولین فیلمی بود که جزئیات اون زیر همه چیز رو میساخت و بعد به بحران میکشید.
About Elly, again, it was an unconscious process. I must insist on that aspect, but it was probably the first film on which I had this idea of this details that are taken for granted, and they are building the actual tension, the crisis that will show at the end.
ما همیشه فکر می‌کنیم که چیزای جزئی توی رفتار روزانه‌مون، توی زندگی روزمره یا توی در واقع گفتارمون، اینا چیزای جزئی‌ان، خیلی اهمیتی نداره، ولی گاهی این چیزای خیلی جزئی اینها هستن که چون بهشون توجه نمی‌کنیم میتونن فاجعه ایجاد کنن. در تو درباره چه اتفاقی می‌افته؟
We tend to neglect the importance of details in our everyday life, in what we say, in our behaviors, in when we talk. But it's About Elly is one of these cases in which some details can cause a disaster.
اون داستان هم توی چند روز خیلی محدود در واقع و توی یه زمان محدودی میگذره. اون نزدیکترین فیلم منه به تئاتر.
This film also takes place in one place and a very short period of time, and this is probably my film that is closest to theater.
همیشه فکر کنم من درباره ایلی رو میتونستم روی صحنه تئاتر ببرم.
I sometimes think that I could have staged it.
Yes, I think it works better as a film. Especially because it's very much about the environment, yeah. Not least is the sea. And I think the theatrical version of the sea wouldn't be as
قطعاً اینجوریه ولی اون در بطن خودش یه ساختار تئاتری داره.
Yes, for sure, but there is still this theatrical essence in the film.
در واقع چیزی که وقتی میگم تئاتری منظورم اینه که مثل این عروسک‌های روسیه که هی باز میکنیم یه عروسک دیگه توشه، یک باز میکنیم، یه خط نمیره جلو، انگار دور یه چیزی داره هی میچرخه روایت.
What I mean is that it's not a linear narrative. It's a kind of Russian doll that you open and there is another doll.
Yes. But that's, in a way, that's true of all your work, really. We won't just talk about a separation for the moment because we've kind of thought about that a bit. But your next film after that, The Past in English, which is in French.
Yes.
And you told me just now, and I was surprised, I thought you were fluent in French but not in Spanish, which you've, because you've made a Spanish film as well. But you tell me you're not fluent in French either. Well, you could have fooled me. but that film, again, The Past, and it's called The Past.
Yeah.
It resonates with the story of the film you haven't made about meeting your friend. And indeed, with all of your films, the things that have happened in the past inform. Do you want to talk about that a bit?
یکی از چیزهایی که از بعد از فیلم جدایی ذهنم رو درگیر کرد و هی داره پررنگتر میشه، شاید هرچی سن آدم میره بالاتر پر رنگ‌تر میشه، این داستان بار سنگین گذشته زندگی آدمه.
Yes, something that really became a concern for me after a separation and it goes, it's not getting any better probably with age, is the burden of one's past.
مثلا شاید برای من به عنوان ایرانی که از اون بخش دنیا میام و فرهنگ ما گذشتمون خیلی چیز مورد بحثیه و خیلی همیشه راجعش داریم حرف میزنیم.
Probably has to do with my culture also. As an Iranian, we're really a people quite obsessed with our past, something that we discuss all the time.
توی فیلم گذشته چیزی که برام چیزی که شاید جالب بود که اون فیلم رو اصلا بسازم این که اتفاقی در زمان حاضر رخ نمیده توی داستان. همه چیزا قبلا اتفاق افتاده، اینا رو دارن هی دوباره بازگویی میکنن.
And what I found interesting in the story and the plot of the past is that there's nothing going on in their present. They're just reviewing over and over what happened in their past.
انگار وضعیت یه چیزی شبیه وضعیت اون زنیه که تو کماست. همه چی انگار توی برزخ بین موندن و نموندن، بین گذشته و حاله.
As if everybody was in the same state as the character who's this lady who's in a coma, that everybody is just between in limbos between being and not being.
Absolutely. It's interesting. I suppose this is quite a big and complicated question, but you referred to the nature of life and society in Iran, although that particular film, although it has Iranian characters, happens in France. But obviously, at a certain level, it's important for us to understand the cultural, political and religious aspects and the social class divisions and things which inform pretty much all of your work. Now, it's not something you can talk about very briefly, but if you would just say something about that.
توی فیلم‌هایی که لااقل بیشتر فیلم‌هایی که توی ایران ساختم، این بخشیه که تماشاگرها توی ایران بیشتر راجبش حرف می‌زنن، یعنی بحث بچه اجتماعی فیلم بیشتر راجع بهش صحبت میشه.
Well, for most of my Iranian films, the film that I shot in Iran, this aspect is the aspect that the audiences relate most to, the social aspect of it.
و خوشبختانه بعد از فیلم‌ها یه گفتگو بین آدما رخ میده که خود این گفتگوه خیلی چیزها، خیلی از سوال‌هایی رو که برای من به وجود داره در حین ساختن فیلم پاسخ میده.
And very often it triggers some discussion, some social debate around these issues that are very interesting for myself as a person, because many of the questions that I brought up are answered through this debate.
همیشه وقتی که به این زاویه که اشاره کردین فکر می‌کنم که کاری که من میتونم بکنم اینه که اون سوال‌هایی رو که در اون ارتباط برای خودم وجود دارم یه جوری با قصه منتقل کنم به تماشاگر.
And so as you're mentioning this, I think my only intention, what I try to do on these aspects is just to come up with these questions, the questions that are mine, and just present them to the audience through the story that I'm telling.
معنیش نیست که این سوالا جواب داره و من جواب رو پنهان میکنم. واقعا بعضی این سوالا اینقدر همونجوری که اشاره کردی که پیچیده است. حالا وضعیت کشور من و وضعیتی که توش هستیم اینقدر پیچیده است که این سوالا جواب‌های مشخصی نیست، نداره. به نظر میاد که جواب‌های بسیار پیچیده‌ای داره. این توی بافت در واقع روایتم میاد.
And it doesn't mean that there is an answer that I am containing and I'm not giving away, or that even there is an answer. I think many of these complexities that you refer to are part of our society, and so they would just leave them open for people to reflect about them.
اگرچه از این نظر خیلی بستر خوبیه کار کردن توی ایران، ولی خود این پیچیدگی کار فیلمساز هم به عنوان کسی که اونجا زندگی میکنه و فیلم میسازه پیچیده میکنه.
So of course as a material it's fascinating, extremely interesting to be living in a society that gives you so much issues to deal with, but it makes your own work difficult also as a creator, as a filmmaker.
But you achieve that. Can we have the next clip, please? Now this is the film, just to change the subject a bit, this is the film which I had the privilege of being, along with the Mayor of London, mm-hmm. When, courtesy of Donald Trump, who banned all Iranians from entering the United States, you, of course, decided that there was no way you were going to go to the Academy Awards. And the Mayor of London screened it in Trafalgar Square, and it was a very big turnout. Was anybody here, there? Yes, quite a few.
And it was rainy day that day.
It was a rainy day, but it made no difference. And I had the privilege with one or two other people of saying a few words. Do you want to talk about that historic event?
دیشب داشتم با دوستان میگفتم یکی از خاطر انگیزترین اتفاقات حرفه‌ای من اون نمایشیه که خود مایک اولش اومد صحبت کرد و چند هزار نفر اونجا بودن و بعد وسط نمایش بارون گرفت و همه نشسته بودن و من داشتم از دور از در واقع برام کلیپاش می‌دیدم، نگران بودم که آیا تا کی میشینن و این فیلم رو میبینن زیر بارون.
Yeah, I was saying with some friends last night that this is one of the most memorable moments of my career, of this screening of Mike introducing the film and then people, thousands of people watching the film outside, and then it started raining. And I was just following it on the clips that they would send me online, and I was worried about how long will people sit under the rain to watch the film, because they all...
Well, you have to remember that in these islands, it rains, you know. But do you want to say anything about your political decision?
من ابتدا تصمیمم بود که برم و میتونستم برم چون گرین کارت داشتم و بعد یعنی وقتی این بحث ترافل بن پیش نیامده بود تصمیمم بود که مثل همه بقیه‌ای که دعوت میشن برم و میتونستم برم، ولی وقتی این بحث پیش اومد و اسم اون هفت کشور اومد و کشور من جزو شد، احساس کردم که دیگه یه جور توهینه.
Well, first I wanted to go. I had just the idea of any people who's invited to go. I even had the green card, so I could have gone. But then once that it was put out there, the name of the seven countries of people of this travel ban and people who are excluded in such an obvious way, I thought that it was quite insulting.
سختم بود این کار رو بکنم چون میدونستم که این توجه ها رو به فیلم من بیشتر میکنه و ممکن از کاندیداهای دیگه توجه ها کمتر بشه. یه دوراهی خیلی سختی بود این تصمیم گیری.
But at the same time it's a very sensitive situation because you know that if you do this then it's gonna attract some specific attention on your film because of this which can harm the other films, so you don't know what to do. It's a kind of dilemma actually.
ترجیح میدادم که در واقع اون اتفاقا نمی افتاد و فیلم مسیر خودش رو میرفت، ولی اتفاق افتاد و من همچنان فکر کنم که چیزی بود که با قلبم بهم میگفت که باید این کار بکنم.
I wish it hadn't happened and the film had been seen only for itself, but then I was put into the situation And still now I think that I was right to follow what my heart told me to do.
موقعی که تصاویر اون نمایش اومد از لندن من می‌دیدم تصاویر یه کسی اونجا بود که برای من عکس تماشاگر رو می‌فرستاد بیشتر که گروه گروه نشسته بودم من نگاه می‌کردم همه‌شون از ملیت‌های مختلف نشسته بودن من انگار که وقتی فیلم و سینما هست دیگه فرقی نمی‌کنه پاسپورت هر کسی مال کجاست این خیلی معنای خاصی داشت برای من اون روز
And what I found very touching at the time is that I had a friend who sent me pictures of the audience of that Trafalgar Square screening, and I received these pictures of people from all over the world, all watching the films, and it was a very important and meaningful message for me. Like,
yeah.
When it's about cinema, when it's about art, there is no nationality or no passport involved.
Very, very incidentally, of course, one of the great things about the occasion in Trafalgar Square, it was great to see what, by ordinary commercial cinema standards, would be an esoteric foreign language film being shown in Trafalgar Square to a huge crowd, which was great. I don't want us to run out of time here, and with lots of things to do, including the possibility of people asking a few questions. So I'm going to... your next film was Everybody Knows, which...
Yeah, Spanish one.
The Spanish film. If you don't mind, we won't talk about that because we're going to talk about a hero in it, which is in the festival. But before we do that, could we have the next clip, please? Yeah. Now, we're showing that clip because one of the things about your films, which I find more impressive than anything, is your extraordinary ability to work with children. And I say that because I've spent a lifetime as a filmmaker avoiding having children characters because I'm never too sure whether I could handle it. Occasionally I've done it, but it isn't in the same department as working with grown-up character actors. And you, in I think pretty well every film, you have the most extraordinary performances from children, and I don't know any other filmmaker that achieves it. Can you talk about how you do that? I just want to know. I want to learn how you do it. You know.
منم هر دفعه که با بچه کار میکنم سر صحنه هستم اون روز که تموم میشه میگم آخرین باریه که با بچه کار میکنم.
I must say that every time I shoot a film with children, at the end of the day, I think this was my last time.
واقعا کار سختیه. اما چیزی که فهمیدم اینه که به بچه ها شاید نباید گفت مستقیماً که چی میخوای.
They do give you a hard time, but I think the way you have to do it is never to ask them directly what you expect from them.
چیزی که من تجربه کردم جالبه بچه‌ها خیلی اهل بازی‌ان زود هر چیزی رو میتونن تخیل کنن و بخشی از بازیشون کنن ولی انگار این بازی رو در انحصار خودشون میدن و وقتی بزرگترای بازی به اسم فیلمسازی دارن میکنن باور نمیکنن مسخره است براشون.
Children are very good at playing, imagining, building up worlds. But as soon as you, as a grown-up, want to enter this world with them, they don't let you in. It's their thing. They don't want to share your game, which is the game of making a film.
من همیشه با بچه‌ها سعی می‌کنم که واقعیت چیزی که قرار بازی می‌کنن رو بهشون نگم و یه داستانی در پشت دوربین بچینم که اونا یه واکنشی به این داستان داشته باشن و واکنششون میشه اون بازیشون.
So I try never to tell them what's the actual scene that they're playing and what they're expected to do in that scene, what's the reality of the scene. I create a parallel world, a parallel scene behind the camera, and I want them to react to it, and the reaction is what I need.
چیزی که خیلی خطرناکه و بیشترین انرژی من در کار با بچه ها برای اینه که سانتیمانتال در نیاد. بچه ها خیلی استعداد این که فیلم رو به یه فضای سانتیمانتال و احساساتی تبدیل کنن دارن تو بازی.
But the fine line that you must be very careful not to cross is the fact of giving to the scene or to the moment with this child is very sentimental aspect because that's the tendency that sure. will be there for.
آخرین چیزی که راجع به بچه‌ها میگم من هیچ موقع داستان فیلم رو به بچه‌ها نمیگم و فیلمنامه‌ام بهشون نمیدم. این خیلی خطر بزرگیه. چون اینا میرن تو خونه و دیگران کمکشون میکنن و خراب میشه همه چی.
Another thing that you must really avoid is to give a script to a child or to tell them a story, because if they have a script and they go home, you'll have all the adults around them will come and with their own advice and ruin it all.
Yes, well, you've confirmed my resolve never to work with children.
Yeah.
Can we have the next clip, please? Can you just talk about the spirit and about the film in a way?
من ترجیح میدم که خود مایک چون نظرش راجع به فیلم تازه دیده نگفته ترجمه مایک صحبت کنه راجع به فیلم.
I'd love to hear you about this film because you haven't told me yet how you felt about it.
I think it's great. I mean, those of us who are afflicted mm-hmm. with the disease of the media give us something particular to resonate with in this film, because the media plays mm-hmm. an important part in what goes on in a way that is quite pernicious mm-hmm. and dangerous. And that's something that I don't think really happens in any of your other films. So,
yeah.
You know, and I think it's great for that reason. It's also great for all the usual reasons we've talked about.
این قصه در واقع برای من بخشش که جالب بود و همچنان جزء وجهایی که جالبه اینه که یه آدم های که یه زندگی خیلی معمولی دارن در یه لحظه در یه روز بعد از ظهر ساعت 4 بعد از ظهر یه کار خوبی میکنن و این بولد میشه و آدم ها میشناسنشون و انتظار دارن همه زندگیشون شبیه گذشته و آیندهشون شبیه همون ساعت 4 بعد از ظهر باشه.
What I found interesting in the story and what I really wanted to tackle was the fact of that one very simple person does something that's considered as a good deed at some specific point, some specific day, at some specific time. They do one thing, and then people know them for this one thing, and they expect that person to have the same value all his life long. His past, his future, all his life must be under the influence at this very moment for which he's been distinguished.
در واقع ابتدا که شروع کردم کار کردم فکر نمی‌کردم یکی از موضوعات اصلی فیلم سوشال مدیا باشه، ولی وقتی که این اتفاق میفته برای یه فرد، طبیعتاً امروزه سوشال مدیا ها که این کار رو به عهده‌شونه که اون آدم رو در واقع نور روش بندازن.
So first I didn't mean to do anything about the social media, it wasn't my subject at all, but then once that it's about this glory, this sudden glory of being put in the spotlight, of course nowadays that comes from the social media.
توی بین قصه‌هایی که من کار کردم این قصه گسترده‌تری داره، آدم‌های بیشتری توشن و انگار جامعه بیشتر درگیره با قصه.
So compared to my other films, this one involves more people, more character, a larger circle. So it has more of a social aspect of in it.
مخصوصا وقتی راجع به جامعه‌ای صحبت می‌کنی که قهرمان پروره.
Especially about this tendency to create heroes in society.
Absolutely.
این یکی از موضوعاتیه که حالا شاید به دوره‌ای که من دانشگاه تئاتر می‌خوندم برمیگرده این کانسپت که تو کار برشتم در واقع به این اشاره میشه و شاید ناخودآگاه از اونجا تو ذهن من مونده که بعدا راجع به این کانسپت یه کاری بکنم.
And maybe this idea of working about the taste for heroes in society is something that comes from my days as a student and as a theater student and Brecht's work, but probably the seed must come from then.
پشت قهرمان پروری به هر حال یه جوری فرار از مسئولیت‌های فردی و اجتماعی پنهانه.
And of course, this tendency of admiring heroes is a way to run away from your own individual responsibilities.
Which the film is full of. That's going on all the time in the film, isn't it? Just let's put our hands together and say thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.